La Casa Italiana zerilli-marimò della New York University. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here tonight for this event that was organized by the Centro Primo Levi along with the other Italian institutions that participate every year in the organization of the series of events devoted to the Giornata della Memoria. And I have to say that it's one of the very, very few occasions in which we sit down all together, Anthony Tamburi of the Calandra Institute, Giorgio Van Strate of the Italian Cultural Institute, myself, our colleagues at Columbia, and also see here the chair of the Department of Italian Studies here at New York University, and Ruth Ben-Ghiat, and talk about how we want to mark this day. And this specific year, out of the input of our friends at the Centro Primo Levi, we decided to pause, not to do something, but ask ourselves, what do we remember, how do we remember, and why? And that's the reason why we are having this panel about museums, that if you want, are the places that are institutionally devoted to the preservation and the diffusion of memories of different kind. I am very grateful to Natalia Indrimi, Alessandro Cassin, the faculty panel that was made up of Ruth Ben-Ghiat, Silvana Patriarca, and Ernest Ialongo, that really created this all-day symposium. And without further ado, I would like to invite to the podium the Deputy Director of the Centro Primo Levi, Alessandro Cassin. Thank you.
Thank you, Stefano. Welcome, everybody. It's always a pleasure to do partner with Casa Italiana. And as Stefano said, Giorno della Memoria has become the one occasion during the year where we, all the Italian cultural institutions and university in New York come together. And as Stefano said, this year what we're attempting with this day of reflection is to see the role, you know, of, on the one hand, January 27, has become the one calendar day shared by the European countries. As the European Union has adopted this, the real question is there a common shared history that could be remembered jointly? And this is obviously an open question and a very political one at the same time. So we were very pleased not only to be able to put together a panel to discuss this specifically, but to have a young generation of scholars who've grown up in a world where these issues have been enormously relevant in their work and in their personal lives. So I would like to thank the Consul General of Italy, the Consul General of France, Germany, all our partners, the Alliance of Colombia, and one of the things that distinguishes this day really for us from our usual way of carrying the celebration of Giorno della Memoria is to have divided it into a morning session, which was a more academic public, to this round table, which is meant for general public. And I think that the combination of the two really shows our commitment to examine this from a multiplicity of standpoints. So for both of us, I see a lot of faces, and I appreciate that people who followed us this morning are again here this afternoon. For those of you who were not with us this morning, the panelist, Guri, Schwarz, who will moderate, will help sum up what was discussed this morning. So without further ado, let me introduce the speakers this evening, which is Guri Schwarz from the University of Pisa, Aline Sierp from the University of Maastricht, Laure Neumayer from the University of Paris Panthéon Sorbonne, Gabor Sonkoly of the Loránd University of Budapest. So if you could come on the stage, I would Thank you very much.
Does it work? Yeah. Sorry. Okay, so I was asked to moderate this afternoon session. I do that with, I'm very happy to do that. And I, first of all, want to thank the Casa Italiana and the other institutions, Primo Levi Center, and all those who helped make this day possible. Now, this morning, as Alessandro said before, we had four long, intense, and fruitful hours of discussion. And we agreed that before we start this more informal roundtable moment of discussion, each of us would present synthetically in 5 minutes or so his perspective, the national case about which each of us are have talked about this morning, so you get more or less a sense of the issues that were raised in the morning, and then from there we can start addressing the underlying problems and the commonalities and the differences between the various scenarios that we face today. So I would ask Aline if she wants to start.
So we said 5 minutes. So I'm not going to repeat everything that I said this morning, but I thought I'd bring you a little bit up to date what we did discuss. And you have the great advantage that here we actually have the possibility of showing some pictures. So I think pictures are sometimes telling more than words. You don't see anything yet. There we go. Okay, perfect. So basically what I did in my presentation is I tried to explain the puzzle of why Munich only opened in 2015, so 70 years after the end of World War II, a museum dedicated exclusively to National Socialism, and particularly the role that Munich played in this. I don't think I have to say very much why this is a puzzle. It's a bit unusual to have such a latecomer in a country that is usually regarded as being a little bit the model when it comes to Vergangenheitsbewältigung, so facing the past. And it's particularly surprising that it's Munich, because Munich, as you probably all know, was a little bit the seeding ground for this particular movement, the movement of National Socialism. So what I did in the presentation is very quickly explained the genesis of this particular museum. I talked about the main difficulties, particularly when it came to financing and to how it's being called. And I tried to contextualize this in the sense that I was talking about Munich being the capital of amnesia, or having often been called the capital of amnesia. I then proceeded to explain to what extent it's breaking with a certain tradition in that sense, or with this tradition of maybe not facing the past of denial. This is where I would like to go a little bit more into detail, so that you know what we're talking about, also because I think this is exactly where it provides the link with the other presentations. If we're talking about museums, we have to ask ourselves, of course, where are we standing nowadays? Have there been developments that have progressed in the last decades, really? To give you a little bit of an idea how this museum looks like. I think where it really breaks with certain traditions is it clearly presents some kind of a bridge to the present in its exhibition. That's a little bit unusual for most museums that are dealing with National Socialism. It's basically clearly asking the question of what has this to do with us today? How is this... this history is still important for us. Where do we have continuities maybe of xenophobic thought? How do we face this? And it's trying to do that because it clearly wants to question the patterns that were behind the establishment of National Socialist thinking, patterns or dynamics that might still be present in today's society. And it dedicates a lot of space to that. It's doing that because it's trying to address a challenge that I think most museums are facing today, which is the whole question of what do we do in a moment where social or communicative memory is being transformed slowly into cultural memory. What do we do with the last eyewitnesses, for example, dying? How do we keep this memory alive? And how do we get the young generations interested in that? And this is certainly a challenge, I think, that comes up also in the other museums that we discussed today. It does, by doing that, it does a break with some kind of a tacit agreement that is present particularly in Germany, which is the agreement of non-comparison. That's something that has been very strong in the last decades in Germany, because there's this idea, it's a political idea, that the Holocaust was unique and that you cannot compare it to anything else. And the moment you move into our contemporary society and challenges that contemporary societies face today, you'd obviously open up the space. You open up the space of comparison, and it's almost impossible to avoid this. So in that sense, I think the museum is quite groundbreaking. And that's maybe also where it links up with a more European trend, if you so want. And we're going to discuss this, I think, in the roundtable just later on. Where, however, it does follow a little bit with a certain tradition that has been there is that it's following the path of objective contextualization. So it lets documents and pictures speak for itself. There's no objects, for example, that could lead to some kind of an auratization. And in that sense, I think German museums are often very different from other museums that you can find in other countries, where there's a lot more focus on the emotional aspects. For example, just think about the Holocaust Museum in Washington or Yad Vashem. To show you a few more pictures so that you know what I'm talking about here, you see the museum from the inside and to what extent it's being integrated into the specific district where you have a lot of historical buildings, and that's part of the aim to have this context. To have at least the one side obviously being a clear break with the past, but then having the visitor engage with the past at the same time. From the inside, it's a very sober kind of architecture. There's a lot of focus on digital media, as you can see here in the forefront. And you have the same also outside. This morning I was talking about the monitors that you have outside the building that are accessible 24 hours per day. So even people who do not go and see the exhibition, they can still have a look at these different monitors. Now to conclude, because I only have 5 minutes, what we were asked to do as well is to talk about the European context of this. So to what extent this specific museum provides some kind of is integrated in some kind of a European discourse that might be there or might not be there. And I think where it certainly links up to other museums is its format. This format of a very new type of museum. The question actually is if it is a museum. The curators themselves don't call it a museum, so that's interesting. It's called a learning center, a learning and commemoration center. And I think we, again, have other examples here where we're talking about houses, so not museums anymore, but houses. And we might discuss together why this is. Then I think where it also fits into some kind of a European trend, if you so want, is that it's clearly moving away from victim sites, and it's concentrating more on the perpetrator side, obviously, because this is a perpetrator site, if you so want, which allows maybe to a greater extent to investigate the reasons for a persecution. It's more difficult to do that on a victim site because victim sites tend to emphasize empathy with the victims, and it's not so much about the reasons for persecution. I think what is what is less strong in this specific context is pressure from the European Union or pressure from other European countries. We've said this morning that this is particularly strong in some countries. I think it's less strong in Germany for very obvious historical reasons. But I think this is again another question that maybe we should discuss together.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And now if Gabor, would you?
Thank you so much. I'd like to make 6 points in the same logic as Aline did. So first, I was talking about how commemoration of the Holocaust is taking place in contemporary Hungary. And of course, Hungary is a small country, but it's very interesting because there's a populist regime since 2010. So in many cases, it's a laboratory to see how the manipulation of the past for political purposes is taking place in several formats. And I started my presentation with the fact that the government declared the year of 2014 the official year of the commemoration of the Holocaust. And already before 2014, there were at least two institutions which were partially or totally in charge of commemorating the Holocaust. One was the Hungarian Jewish Museum, which was established in 1916. Here, you can see, actually, this is in the biggest synagogue in Europe. And the other one was the Holocaust Memorial Center, a documentation center, which was initiated in 1999 and inaugurated in 2004. But the government felt the necessity to add a new project, which was started in 2013, which is called the House of Faiths. And actually, its full name is House of Faiths, Place of Memory for the Infant Victims of the Holocaust. And it's actually a suburban railway station in the 8th district of Budapest, which was one of the places of the deportation, which was turned to be a special house of commemoration. You can see on the right side that the building was finished. It cost more than $25 million, but it has never been opened. And it seems to be that the opening is cancelled for good, because it was questioned and rebuked by the international and Hungarian Jewish communities, saying that this is actually an abuse of the past, and because the original plan was to show how non-Hungarian, the non-Jewish Hungarian population was eager to save lives, and this is not the main message of Holocaust. Actually the year of the commemoration was paralyzed by the conflict between the government and the Jewish organizations, the biggest Hungarian association, religious association, Jewish association, offered another project, which is called the House of Coexistence, which was supposed to be realized in a 19th century synagogue, which was designed by Otto Wagner. Actually, the plan is now subsidized by the Hungarian state, but not under the name of this House of Coexistence, but rather just as a cultural Jewish cultural center. So if to sum up the Hungarian situation, there's no lack of institutions commemorating the Holocaust in Hungary. There are at least five, three realized, one closed, and one in plan. But it shows us not only how the contemporary Hungarian government and the concerned communities try to institutionalize memory, but also the complexity of contemporary Hungarian society. And since the main concern of our debate in the morning was how memory museums function, similarly to Aline, I'd like to put emphasis on the fact that there might be a paradigm shift in from museums to houses or centers. It didn't happen by chance. And it's actually what we could witness in social sciences and humanities from the 1980s onwards, this kind of questioning the credence and the 19th century or early 20th century foundation of the sciences can be also witnessed in museology itself or any kind of critical approach to the past and canonization, what we want to keep and forget from the past. And in the debates of current debates among historians, and actually I cited François Hartog, an eminent French historian, he talks about the changing regimes of historicity, saying that for him every period can be defined by the fact which part of time, past, present, and future, is on the focus, and for him. Modernization or the modern period is more characterized by a future-focused attitude, whereas our present period from the 1970s, 80s onwards is more focused on present. And of course, living in the present is coupled with the problem of uncertainty, and it demands its own vocabulary, and that's why history and critical approach is replaced by a quartet. For him, it's by memory, commemoration, heritage and identity, very fuzzy terms which are difficult to identify or determine, but very easy to refer to. And actually, but at the same time, the modernist institutions and the modernist approaches are still there, so there's a coexistence between these presentist institutions like the houses and the centers and modernist institutions like the museums, and each other they challenging each other. And I concluded that between the two areas, so the history and social sciences and these presentist approaches and institutes, there's a gray zone what politicians really prefer, because it's very easy to manipulate. A question was raised in the debate, whether is there any need for the museums? And I think, of course, there were many answers, but I'd like to insist on one aspect, that this presentism is coupled with uncertainty, and people wants to have anchorage of identity in these uncertainties. And if they don't have it, they create it. So there's a constant need for positive identity. Just two examples. In France, in 1978, there was the International Year of Women. 79, International Year of Children. So what to do in 1980? We can't have an International Year of Fathers, so there was the International Year of Heritage. And this was the year when hundreds of little museums were opened. And in Hungary, to find another date for that, 2000, which was the millennium of the foundation of the Hungarian state, the right-wing government at that time initiated a project, and there were hundreds of festivals created that time, and they are still there. So there's a need to create positive identity and anchorage for that. The question is, who's taking charge of this creation? So this new presentist situation creates or uses a popular demand, which is very much coupled with a power game, as we could see in the Hungarian case, how the government or regional and other instances take are in charge or tries to occupy this new gray area. And of course, I don't have much time to talk about, but we can't forget the context, the national and political context of these memory museums. And when I showed you the institutions, we have to put it into context of present-day Budapest, which is there's a constant struggle for creating symbolic and redefining symbolic places. This is the World Heritage Site of Budapest. And actually, there are three lieux which are very important for the identity building. The first one is the castle district, which was, of course, a political, the place of political representation when Hungary was a kingdom, but after the it was totally destroyed during the Second World War. And there was a consensus under communism that this place will be given for cultural institutes, National Gallery, National Library, etc. Nowadays, the new regime is taking possession of that. So the academy and the museums are expelled from the area, and this is the building what the prime minister is taking for himself and actually refurbishing, not respecting even the monumental legislation of the country. And the couple of this area, the other one is the Hero Square, which used to be the place of political representation of the country, and the museums are put there around that, the new national museums, etc. So you can see a shift how one edge of the city is replaced by the other. And if you couple it with the third one, and that was in the media all over, there's the Parliament, the Kossuth, and the Liberty Square, which is very loaded. I just want to show you a few examples. You can have the square here. You know that president, probably this is Ronald Reagan, walking from the Parliament to the American Embassy through the Soviet monument and not far from the first monument of Governor Horthy, who was the governor of Hungary between 1920-44, and under his rule, the first racist and anti-Jewish laws were accepted. And also on the same square, just to show you, this is very important for Hungarian nation building, the Hero Square, and we have the paraphrase of this built a few years ago by the government. This is actually the monument to commemorate the victims of the Second World War, which shows, of course, Hungary as a victim of German occupation, totally innocent in the Holocaust. And immediately there was a very important civil uprising against the monument. And you can see how for months there were living chains around that, showing that this is total falsification of the past. So how to conclude this on the European level? Of course, Europe also navigates in this gray zone. Cultural heritage, which is one of the key concepts of the gray zone or this presentist quartet, is all over in the Hungarian, in the European calls, in the Horizon 2020 call. And because cultural heritage and this gray zone is very useful to integrate economic and social expectations and culture together in the name of sustainability, etc. At the same time, Europe keeps failing to give a positive identity. Of course, it's a bit theatrical, but I think it's very... I will finish my short presentation with the bon mot of Jean Monnet. Maybe he didn't say that, but everybody keeps repeating it in Brussels. If I had to do it again, I would have begun with culture. So Europe keeps failing to give a cultural identity, still afraid of interfering national affairs. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Gabor. And now I pass the floor to Laure.
I don't have a PowerPoint presentation. Okay, so I will also try to give you a quick summary of what my presentation was about this morning. I was asked to discuss the remembrance of Nazi and communist crimes in Central Europe. And at the EU level after the end of the Cold War. Am I speaking? Shall I speak up maybe a bit? Okay.
So what I tried to discuss this morning was the attempts to build a shared narrative of the past in the European Union and the way they have been transformed after the end of the Cold War. And especially the tensions that occurred when the European Union enlarged to post-communist member states. Because this enlargement actually challenged the established patterns of remembering the common past in Western Europe, which had been patterns which had been established in the 1970s in the EU member states of that time, and which had been Europeanized in the 1990s. So after the end of the Cold War, there was what some authors called the competition of victims, or to try to establish a common narrative and to discuss which episodes of the European history should be included in this narrative. So the debate over the boundaries of the European political space actually turned into a debate about the legacies of the past and what past are considered to be relevant on a pan-European scale. And why was it so conflictual? Because it was conflictual because social actors, political actors from post-communist Europe had been building a narrative of their past, the particular past of Central Europe, which was relied on the equivalence of communist crimes and Nazi crimes. And what I tried to explain this morning was that this narrative, which puts communism on a par with Nazism, had been created mainly in museums of communism, which had been established since the early 1990s in Central Europe, very often created by former political prisoners or former dissidents or former exiles. And these museums have been very much criticized on several respects. One of them is that they often give a very simplistic vision of history, with on the one hand the victims, on the other hand the perpetrators, and which doesn't really allow for a complex discussion of the past. And the second problem that those museums cause is that the fact that they often are dedicated to communism and completely screen out the Holocaust or mention it only in a way to demonize communism by association with Nazism. And this morning I gave examples of museums in the Baltic countries, for example, which are particularly representative of this trend. What's important also is that those museums are very much in contact with victims' associations, with institutes of national remembrance, which were created in post-communist Europe to manage the files of the repression apparatus and also to create this official narrative of what socialism was. So these museums, the institutes of national remembrance, have created networks which try to upload this narrative onto the European level and to impose this narrative of about the socialist period in the European institutions. And this morning I mentioned the most active of these networks, which is the Platform of European Memory and Conscience, which was created in 2011. And has published a reader for high school students and also put up a traveling exhibition about communist crimes. So why is it relevant to our discussion, and I will try to be brief, to our discussion about whether we are going towards a shared European history or shared representation of history in Europe? I think there really has been a change or a shift after the Cold War in the way the past of Europe is discussed. and a shift towards more conflicts or more conflicts about what should be included in this narrative and how the past should be presented. And I think the post-communist member states of the European Union have played a very active role in first challenging this, what Aline was mentioning, that this agreement of non-comparison, the fact that the Holocaust was a unique historical event, and that it should not be compared, because comparison leads to minimalization, not realization. So that's something which was part of the Western representation of the past, and which is directly challenged in Central Europe. And also, I think why this case of communist crimes is important, the second reason why it's important, is that it's also those claims for recognition are also illustrate the tension between universal values or kind of defense of fundamental rights, which is at the core of the EU discourse about itself, and also so the tension between those universal values on the one hand, and on the other hand, some claims which can seem particularistic because they relate only to one part of Europe. And the challenge for these museums of communism or for the platform of European memory and conscience is to articulate those values which have a universal relevance and their claims which are very much linked to a particular history and a vision of history which is clearly not shared in other parts of Europe. And I think I will stop here for now, and
okay, thank you, and now briefly I'll present a synthesis of my paper for this morning. I spoke about the Italian situation, where, well, the first thing to say is that the birthplace of fascism has no museum of fascism. And it actually has no significant museum dedicated to the first part of the 20th century. It has some memorial sites, some small museums born in the first decades of the post-war era, which are not really, sometimes they're called museums, but they're not really museums. They're memorials where the aesthetic dimension dominates on everything, and where the key element of the narrative is to celebrate the sacrifice of Italians who have purged the nation through their sacrifice of fascist sins. They celebrate anti-fascist martyrdom. They're not historical museums. I'm thinking about the Museo Nazionale della Liberazione in Via Tasso, which was a Nazi jail, or other similar sites. In recent years, well, actually at the beginning of the 21st century, a series of initiatives with significant funding being provided by the state started and seemed promising. Initiatives aimed at building, well, first and foremost, Holocaust museums. Now, it all began in 2001 when, during the Berlusconi government of the time, what was then Under Secretary of State to the Ministry of Cultural Heritage, Vittorio Sgarbi from Ferrara, his hometown, declared that it would be a great idea to build a Holocaust Memorial Museum in Ferrara, who was also the city of the well-known writer Giorgio Bassani, so that had some meaning. 2 years after, a law was passed in Parliament giving a significant amount of money, several million euro, for the building of the museum. After that, in 2006, nothing had been done. No significant project had been elaborated. and in a new and different political scenario, what was at the time the mayor of Rome, Walter Veltroni, a key figure in the Italian left, declared that he would do the Holocaust Museum in Rome. And he obtained rapidly funding from the state through a law passed in parliament to do such a museum. So for a while, Italy had potentially two museums funded by the states, one in Ferrara and one in Rome. Of course, that couldn't work. So a solution was found with an amendment passed in parliament shortly after. The Ferrara Museum would be transformed in a national museum on the history of Italian Jews. All the history of Italian Jews from ancient times until today, covering over 2,000 years of history. But the mayor of Ferrara was not happy because he felt that, you know, yes, the history of Italian Jews is interesting, but what really counts is having the Holocaust Museum. So he obtained another amendment that clarified that in Ferrara you would have a national museum of Italian history of Italian Jews and the Holocaust. Well, Rome was supposed to have the National Museum of the Holocaust. Since then, we're in 2017, nothing happened. We have no museum in Ferrara and we have no museum in Rome. Two architectural projects were passed a selection, and in theory we have the architectural projects for both museums. We do not have the cultural projects. We don't know what is supposed to be in those museums, how those museums are supposed to be articulated. Specifically, if we talk about the Roman Museum on the Holocaust, it's not clear even if it's supposed to be a museum on the Holocaust in general or specifically on the Italian side of the Holocaust. Now, having said this, the other thing that I tried to say this morning is that to understand these dynamics and even the fact that these museums have not been created, we need to take a step back and understand how Italian cultural politics interacted with European memorial policy and how Holocaust memory interacted with the anti-fascist narrative since, well, at least since the 1980s. The issues concerning these museums are connected, first of all, with the introduction of new memorial laws, new laws that introduced new dates in the civil calendar. A whole set of new memorial days have been introduced into the Italian calendar in the last 15 years or so, but I'll mention the three most relevant ones for our purposes. In the year 2000, Holocaust Memorial Day was introduced by law. In the year 2004, what is called in Italian il Giorno del Ricordo was introduced with the aim of commemorating the victims of the violence perpetrated by Yugoslav partisans under Tito against Italians on the northeastern border, Italians who were in many cases fascist. And that was, the first was an operation by a center-left government, the second was an operation by a very right-wing government with a right-wing parliamentary majority. The first put emphasis on the crimes of, well, the Nazis more than the fascists. The second on the crimes of the communists. Then, in 2005, a third date, which actually had a lesser impact on public opinion and much lesser echo, but still relevant. In 2005, another date was added to strengthen this anti-communist element. What is called the Day of Liberty, to commemorate the fall of the Berlin Wall and to commemorate all the victims of communism. Now, you see the process there. From the point of view of the right, you could not challenge the central role acquired by Holocaust memory. But you could flank it with other memorial days, with other narratives that introduce some kind of competition. Now, these dynamics are different, and yet they remind us something of things that happen elsewhere in Europe, where communism has been a regime, not like Italy, where the communists were very important, but cut out from government because, well, we know the situation. On the back of all this, behind all this, I think we have to keep in mind how since the late 1980s, the crisis of the anti-fascist narrative leads to a complex reorganization of discourse on fascism, anti-fascism, and the Holocaust. And if we want to, this has direct political implications, meaning that the direct political implications are what role do the neo-fascists have in Italian political life, and what role do the communists have in Italian political life? Now, in the late 80s, coherently with the political project being developed by then leader of the Italian Socialist Party, Bettino Craxi, Renzo De Felice, a famous historian who also played a completely different role as a public intellectual, gives a very, very well-known interview on the Corriere della Sera, and he makes a political statement. He says, we need a new republic, and to found a new republic, we need to get rid of the myths of the old one, and the basic myth is the anti-fascist myth. We need to include the neo-fascists inside Italian political life. And now when he says that, his interviewer, who is a well-known political and cultural agitator, Giuliano Ferrara, says, Professor, do you realize that, you know, our readers will be shocked by what you're saying? You're saying that we have to set aside the values of anti-fascism and accept the neo-fascists. And he says, yes, but look, as a scholar, and he puts on his professor cap, as a scholar, I tell you, Italian fascism was much better than all other fascist experiences. Why? Well, because Italy is outside the shadow of the Holocaust. So then Holocaust memory becomes a key element in, from the right's point of view, an operation that legitimizes an opening towards a neo-fascist and setting aside anti-fascist memory, while conversely, automatically, from the point of view of the left, from that moment on, demonstrating that fascist anti-Semitism had been seriously implemented, had found true roots in Italian historical tradition, becomes just as relevant to oppose that political process. And the dynamics that start there are dragged on through the 1990s and into the following decades, and have been going on for, well, until very, very recently. Finally, the other thing that, from my point of view, is, I think, crucial, and of which I'm convinced, although I realize it's, here we're in the field of personal opinion, I believe that if we look at the context in which, since the 1990s, the European Union developed its own memorial policy and the role played by Holocaust memory in that memorial policy, it's a project that's strictly, very clearly connected with faith in the inevitable success of the liberal democratic model and of free market society and economy. Today, that world seems very, very far. My idea is that we can discuss today about these things because that season is over, or is in its final and declining stage. And this somehow allows us a distance, whether we welcome that distance or not, but that allows us to understand those dynamics that in many ways are behind us. So this is a brief summary, and I think that from here, that this was meant to introduce those of you who were not present this morning to the key elements of our presentations. And I think that from here we can start a more informal discussion, first of all among us, and then we'll open to the public. And I think that, well, there are a lot of things that came out. But one first issue is the role of the state and the role of politics in all of this. We're talking about museums, and so the first thing that would come to mind is their educational role, their relationship to scholarship. But what we're really talking about is politics. It's, I guess, the meaning of what Gabor meant when he was talking about presentism. Not only that, but I guess that's one of the key elements. So I guess what I want to ask the other panelists is there really anything beyond politics in these projects? Or is the political confrontation really consuming everything else, the scholarly and the intellectual engagement and the educational purposes? So I think we can start from here and then see how our discussion proceeds. I don't know if anyone wants to address this first issue. Yeah, I can. I'll also sit down.
I think we certainly have a big difference between Central and Eastern Europe and Western Europe here when it comes to this. Because when it comes to anything that is there beyond politics, I think at least for the case that I presented, the German case, I think there's certainly something beyond politics. And this probably has to do with the fact that Germany went through a very different trajectory to a certain extent. I think the times of the big contestations were over in the 1980s. This is more or less when both main political currents found some kind of an agreement on how to deal with this past. And since then, there has not really been a lot of contestation anymore. So when I talked about the difficulties that the documentation center faced, this was really more difficulties on the level of, well, like I said, financing or fairly minor issues of how you're going to call it, the name of the center, not necessarily about the content. And I think that's very, very different in Central and Eastern Europe, where we're dealing with a history that is hot. If we use Charles Meyer's words of hot memory and cold memory. I think in the German case, the Holocaust memory has started to become a cold memory, which is, it's not an evaluation, right? It only means that the amount of contestation around it has certainly diminished. And that means that there is space for something beyond politics. It's not a battleground anymore, if you so want. I think it allows for more reflection on the role of museums when it comes not only to commemoration of the victims, but also to the question of the learning impact that they might have. But I suspect that your answers will be very different here.
I'd like to refer to the hot and the cold memory. I'm not sure it's a valid dichotomy. I mean, if you call it, it's very similar. But Levi-Strauss said that there are hot and cold societies and civilizations, and it can't be kept anymore. If hot means dynamic, there is certainly, as you could see in my presentation, it's very hot. But it's not hot politically only. It also depends where we put in which discourse the issue of Holocaust. If we keep it only political changes and we say that the right wing is in the Hungarian case, in exploiting it for its other purposes. It's also interesting that the left wing didn't really deal with it. It just accepted a universal discourse which wasn't satisfactory. So it's interesting that in the morning we mentioned that should we keep this dichotomy between the universal and the national references. It's really true that it's okay if we don't accept only that there's the universal reference, but we can't. Maybe in Central Europe, it seems to be that there's no consensus what the nation is. It's not only a Hungarian problem. There was no consensus even in the 20th century, and it's a Polish case also, and the others. I think in those countries which we see the most extreme regimes at the moment are those which couldn't really conceive a consensus on their national identity. I'm not sure that this is... it's an interesting case whether in Western Europe there's no more problem with the national identity at all. When we talk about the immigrants, other minorities, confessions, can we really, because even Central Europe is so complex in its, I mean, it's, you can't really say that there's one pattern, as we could say. I mean, of course, the Polish problem colleague couldn't come, but if we only say, you know, the Baltic states and the others, I think it's very much different in every country. So I think we have to be careful with this Central Eastern, etc. The other thing, whether it's only political, of course, it has a very important political reference, but it's very much social and even academic. If you have 1 minute, I'd like to give an example. My faculty was commemorating the Holocaust also. And the project was to make a monument for that in the university. And it's kind of important because this is the biggest and the oldest, whatever, university in Hungary, so it's a reference point. And the point was, should it be the memory of the Jewish victims or all the victims of the Second World War? And finally, the faculty agreed that it should be a monument of the Second World War. And and we should put the names on it. And of course, the names were very difficult to collect, but 90% of the victims were victims and the others were soldiers. So we put on the same monument the perpetrators, if you wish, and the victims. And of course it was harshly criticized by others, saying that you can't do it with a monument. And it entered a social debate also, can we remember or forget together? What should we, who could make the division? And if we repeat the past division in the present, are we remaking the same division or not? And this was the Faculty of Humanities, which was criticized, it's very interesting, by the Faculty of Social Sciences. And there were two actually different approaches, the role of Jewish population in Hungary. The sociologists are still teaching a principle that Hungarian society from the early 20th century is a double society. There's a Jewish modernized and the non-Jewish or a rural part of it. And one of the problems of Hungarian nation building is this double face, which is totally refuted by historians. It's a very simplistic dichotomy. But it was very interesting to see how this scientific debate was used to interpret this monument. So it's not just political, it's also scientific, I suppose, and social.
Is there anything? I also think that there is something beyond politics in these museums. Whether you talk about the national level or the relation between those national museums, again in Central Europe, and European the European scale. I think that in post-communist Europe, there is also something very basic, which is that the state violence during the Soviet period is something that was not discussed openly, and that those museums, despite their flaws, are a space where they can be discussed, and where these white pages of history can be contested, can be put into a debate that involves a wide variety of actors, not only academics, but also victims, NGOs, etc. So I think there is a social relevance to these museums. I think also that, as Gabor was saying, those museums play a role in the affirmation of independence of those countries, not only the Baltic countries after the dissolution of the Soviet Union, but their role in identity building is extremely important. And finally, if you look at the relation between those countries and Western countries or European organizations, I think there are also those museums play a role as a tool for recognition. Recognition of these nations as part of the European community, and not in the institutional sense, but in the cultural sense, recognition that the history of those nations is part of the European history. And I think that's symbolically an extremely important task, and something that is necessary for the European Union if it wants to exist in a way that is not completely blocked by divisions. And I think that we are witnessing quite strong divisions between those countries and other European countries on many issues, and that this discussion about history and identity is really crucial if we want the European Union to overcome, or to try to overcome those conflicted visions of the past. So I think obviously there is a lot of politics in those museums, but they go beyond that, I would say.
Moving on from that point, you mentioned, you know, the European project, and Gabor before cited Jean Monnet, and I should have started from culture, something like that. He said it, he didn't say it. It's part of the myth, so but it's still a very nice phrase. And it tells us something about the European Union, even if it's not true, that somehow there's a problem there with culture and identity. And in different ways, I guess less so for Germany, for the well-known reasons, the pressure from the European Union was central in stimulating, on the one hand, in the introduction of memorial laws and then the creation of museums. And in a certain way, we can say there was also a feedback process. It's not only the countries that are receiving the input and the pressure, but they're also, you know, bringing their perspective into the European framework. So, at the beginning, we had the introduction of a Holocaust Memorial Day, which is the only common commemorative date celebrated by all EU member states, even if on different dates of the calendar. And then since 2008, if I'm not mistaken, a group of former Eastern Bloc countries plus then I think only Sweden adopted another date, which is the date of the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact, as another commemorative date, and that was then brought to and adopted by the European Parliament. So there we see the feedback. And one of the issues I think that came out today was the relationship between these national dynamics and this transnational or international process that has to do with the role played by the Union and its attempts to define itself also through memory politics. And as we're talking now, it seems that that's all there is. Of course, there's a lot more to the European Union. But I think maybe it's interesting if we talk a little bit about what this European memory policy was, what form it took. And I think maybe I would like to ask to Laure if she talks to us a little bit about that and the European House of Memory, which was a big project. Who, I don't know if, like the Italian museums, it will ever appear or not. But
So a few words maybe about the European politics of memory. I think the House of European History is just the latest development in a policy which actually started as soon as the European Community was created. This policy was not called Remembrance at the time because it was not a term that was as fashionable as it is today. The EC already in the late 50s or 60s started to implement some policies which were aimed at fostering a sense of European identity, at also giving legitimacy to those institutions by stressing common past and shared values. And I think what's interesting is that during the Cold War, the way this past was put into an official narrative was really by insisting on a common past which was a very old past, I mean a very past very far away, the Greek and Roman civilization, the Enlightenment, and the Second World War was portrayed as a founding event of the European Community, but the specificity of the Holocaust or the Holocaust itself was not mentioned at the European level. So the Second World War, of course, played a role in this discourse about the past, but in quite a general way and as a very broad lesson, which was that European states have to cooperate. And it's only after the Cold War in the 1990s that the Holocaust gained this prominent place in this European discourse. Probably because it was this evolution had started already in the 70s in the nation states of the EU, and also why after the Cold War, probably also because of the end of the Soviet bloc, which was a very direct reason for the EC to be created. So now that the European Union had lost this kind of counter model, the moral justification or the axiological justification for European integration was found not only in the Second World War in general, but in the Holocaust. And for that reason, the European Parliament adopted a lot of resolutions, I think about 20 resolutions on the Holocaust and Holocaust-related issues between 1989 and 2009, not only commemorating the Holocaust, but also questions of restitution of stolen property. There were resolutions on the preservation of sites of the Holocaust, especially the Auschwitz camp. And what's important also, I think, is that those resolutions were addressed to post-communist countries even before they joined the European Union. In the 1990s, there were resolutions about the preservation of Auschwitz and against this idea that it should be turned into something else than just a memorial. So very early on, even before they joined the European Union, the post-communist states were under pressure to not only adopt the patterns of commemoration of the Holocaust, which were prevailing in Western Europe, but they were also under pressure to recognize their own participation in the Holocaust and the fact that the extermination of the Jews was not only brought about by Nazi occupation, but also because some parts of those societies were more or less actively involved in the persecution of the Jews. So I think the narrative on the past that was produced by the European Union changed quite drastically after the end of the Cold War, and there were tensions about the way that the weight that the Holocaust should have, which those tensions appeared even before the enlargement. But after 2004, the new member states had more political power to try to assert their own vision of what the Holocaust meant for those societies in relation to what came after, which is the Soviet period. So this policy at the European Union level changed also after the enlargement, because the European Union created an explicitly a public policy which is explicitly devoted to remembrance, which is called active remembrance, it's a very exciting program, isn't it? Something which treats remembrance as a tool, actually, to strengthen democratic values, to strengthen citizenship, in the European Union. So remembrance has become a tool for public policy, or it's meant to be a tool for public policy, although whether it's an efficient tool is far from being certain. And I think this remembrance policy was probably created then because of those conflicts and because the very different vision of the past was suddenly brought on the European Union's agenda. So this remembrance policy was also meant to facilitate the coexistence of those visions, those divergent visions of the past. And the House of European History is another aspect or another element of this remembrance policy, probably doesn't exist in English, but in French we say serpent de mer, psy serpent, which means something that everybody talks about but nobody's seen, and probably because it doesn't exist, but anyway, it's part of the conversation. And the House of European History has been kind of a serpent de mer in the last 10 years because it's been, the project was launched by the President of the European Parliament, Hans-Gert Pöttering, in 2007, or the idea was launched, and it was there was a very strong support from the European Parliament to create a new museum in Brussels, very close to the European institutions, which was supposed to present the history of Europe, and not only the history of European integration, because that already is something that exists as part of the European Parliament. And for the last 10 years, there has been a lot of discussions and debates about what the narrative of this museum should be, what's how far back in the past it should go, whether it should start very recently after 1945 or go back to ancient Europe, and also how to try to again the same issue, how to find a way to discuss history which would be acceptable from various parts of Europe. So the museum, I think, was supposed to open in 2014. We are in February 2017. And now the latest date on the website was May 2017. So we have a few months to wait and see what happens next.
In this context, it's important to mention as well that the European Union, that might be obvious to us, but it's maybe not obvious to everyone, doesn't have any legal, how do you call this in English, competences in memory politics, of course. That's really important to know, I think, and this is one of the reasons why they have used other tools, if you so want. So they used cultural policy, as Laure rightly said, and they're using this new program. It's actually not that new, it's a third circle of funding that they're going into at the moment, Active European Remembrance, which is part of the citizenship program. So that's interesting, because it's trying to, it uses a tool for public sphere formation. And we all know, everyone who's dealing with the European Union, it's one of the problems the EU has, that there's no such thing as a public sphere. And this might explain some of its failures as well, if you so want. So what they were trying to do is to create a financial tool that allows grassroots initiatives to flourish. So the idea behind it is really that it's not a top-down approach, but that through financial means, organizations, museums, NGOs, etc., can come up with projects that allow for dialogue. And this has been fairly successful. The only interesting thing is, if you talk about the East-West dichotomy that we had here before, is that there's a lot of organizations that are dealing with Holocaust memory, for example, and there's a lot of organizations who are dealing with the memory of communism, but there's very little cooperation between the two. And I think that already says something about the kind of problems we're dealing with here. This division of Europe, if you so want, these different narratives that are standing next to each other, and the difficulty of integrating them into some kind of a common framework.
Yeah, I mean, Jean Monnet probably never said that sentence, but it became very fashionable at the end of the mandate of Barroso, who put actually into his focus the culture, and he was kind of regretting how he omitted culture. And there was a kind of this, and of course, it's always like that, that the European, or the DJs, and the establishment started working out projects of culture, because Barroso said this is not primarily an economic and financial crisis was Europe is living through, but it's much more also a cultural one. But when Juncker came to power, and his famous 10 points, culture wasn't mentioned. And even in his program, culture wasn't mentioned. That's why the establishment itself started saying that Europe just can't ignore culture that much anymore. So somehow the administrator bureaucrats were sneak back culture to the debate. And that's how it's interesting to see the horizon 2020 when it's the key term is reflective societies. And that's another European term which was proposed by the German delegation, and the others didn't understand. And we don't really know what, I mean, of course, we can all imagine what a reflective society means, but we don't really have an academic definition of reflective society. But it's not an obstacle that since academics must define their calls or proposals according to that, now we use this term. So that's why I think it's important to say that Europe is still hesitant, of course, because of competences also, to give any, not a guidance, but even patterns of remembrance or dealing with these issues. And it's, I think Laure explained it very well, how the House of European History is a kind of, in German, the lame Ente, the lame duck, who just can't really find its way to show itself. But it's also problematic, all the other initiatives, European initiatives, to give a positive identity. European Heritage Label, which started 2014, and there was also
They said that we should think of create sites like the World Heritage Sites, of course the troubled one, etc. But there's no financing for that, so that's very it's a funny message that there are no 29 sites which are supposed to be bottom up, which are supposed to reflect cooperation and all the European values, but without any financing, or even the financing of the central office will stop in 2020. So it's very interesting to see how hesitant Europe is to go through or even find these. Of course, for the rememberers, you find good examples, but for other ones, it's I think the institutionalization is extremely slow, and that's also probably Europe is paying with credibility for that.
Just one thing to clarify for those who maybe are not, where Horizon 2020 is the main project for financing research, academic, scientific research in the European Union and to other non-European Union states who collaborate. Sorry?
For 7 years.
Yeah, for it's. So one other thing that I think lies on the background of what we said this morning and somehow we've touched indirectly today is a very obvious, of course, is how do these museums work for the public? What is the educational result in terms of, you know, you get into it and how are you changed if in any way by that experience, or how should you be? I'll start by saying a few things about the illusions, well, that's the best word I can find, of Holocaust education and politics of commemoration, including the ideas of the museums. We don't have the museums, as I told you, in the Italian case. One of the key elements that was placed there from the beginning was the idea that Holocaust education would make better citizens, that you would educate these children, bring them to see something horrible and terrible, and they would become more tolerant, more acceptant of differences. And I have several reservations and doubts about that, but I will just present you with what I think is an interesting take on the matter by an Italian scholar from the University of Turin who teaches pedagogy, and he looked at a series of student questionnaires of students who have made educational trips to Auschwitz. Now, Italy is one of the countries that invests the most in educational trips to Auschwitz for high school students. It's, I think, the fourth country in terms of number of visitors to Auschwitz globally, but if you look at the number of students, it's the second one, right after Poland, and the Polish have an objective geographic advantage. So it's meaningful. There's a lot of money invested in these programs. And so the scholar studied these questionnaires and he reached the following conclusion, that the students after these experiences may come back in basically three different ways, change it in three different ways. The first kind, he said, are the students who come back and are totally fixated on everything that is Holocaust related. They start reading books and watching movies, and that becomes the center of their world. It becomes an obsession, okay? The second are those who come back and they become basically Nazis. They are fascinated by that project and their only preoccupation is, well, that it was not brought to completion, and they think that's a good way to deal with those unwelcome foreigners who are coming to our country. The third way, he said, which is possibly the best way, is those who come back as gladly as they were before. Now, if that's the best possible outcome, then I guess there are problems with the whole educational project. Now, this is, of course, in many ways, a provocation. But it I think it raises some of the key issues that that we face when we talk about these museums. And I'm talking about schools and school children, because, well, who goes to museums? Well, tourists and school children mainly. So I think that's one issue. I don't know if any of you has.
That's a very difficult question, because how do you measure impact when it comes to visits? I was working before going back to academia. I was working at the Dachau concentration camp memorial site, and one of the questions we always asked ourselves, of course, was the question of impact. What does it do with visitors? And one of my tasks and one of my big projects when I was working there was an international visitors survey, which was trying to deal with these questions. And I discovered very quickly that it's almost impossible to measure impact, simply because there's too many other factors that play into this. And you cannot possibly, you could obviously do a survey of people before they come to visit the place, and then you do another survey the moment you exit. But having a direct correlation between the different answers is something very dangerous. So we decided to not do that, to not interfere, basically, or have create direct links between the two. So I think that the educational results are probably something that you could measure maybe in different ways by looking at long-term effects, and not something that happens immediately after. What you could probably try to see is to what extent, or how people react to certain presentations, but I think you cannot do much more than that, simply because there's too many other factors that play into the overall result.
I totally agree, of course, that measuring impact is impossible, and the scholars' notes and the three types of reaction that I mentioned before was more a provocation than anything else, but still somehow I think interesting. But one thing is measuring impact, and another is measuring or understanding what we want, beyond the effects, but what we expect. The expectation, at least in the Italian scenario, is to create better citizens. That this is... If we look at the narrative that is built around... If you look at the programs that have been put in place, the emphasis and the what they say on all these educational trips is to remember for something, not just to remember. I disagree. Well, you have the documents there of groups like Dana, of Aned. And if you look at the documents with which they propose their trips and the meaning that they give to those trips, the trips to Auschwitz and to the other camps, they don't just say it's important to remember. They add they introduce reasons. They say it's important to remember in order to introduce a series of values. One of the things that comes up all the time is the idea of a tolerant society. One of the things that comes up also all the time on another level, which is that of public discourse, is the idea and the comparison with the relationship between Holocaust memory and the reactions we should have towards migrants and immigration. Especially in the Catholic press, that is very, very strong. Not long ago, there was a cover of Famiglia Cristiana, which is a very well-known Catholic weekly, that had the picture of a black boy on a boat in the Mediterranean, and the title was "If This Is a Man." These kind of refractions are very, very strong. The idea is that because we remember, we should be, or that memory should lead us to be more accepting and so on and so forth. That was, by the way, very explicit even long before. If you do a research, well, you cannot do it today because they have put away the archive, the online archive, but if you, until a few weeks ago, the online archive of the UNITA was accessible. And if you did a research looking for the phrase rilanciare l'antifascismo tramite l'antirazzismo, so to relaunch anti-fascism through anti-racism, and indicate the time period since the late 80s and through the early 90s, that's something that comes back all the time. So there is a goal. There is, it's not just to remember. That remembrance has political and has moral implications that are made explicit in different contexts and in different ways. Of course, the sensibility of the Catholics and that of the former communists are different, but it's not just remembrance per se. Also, if you look at the documents of the Italian Ministry of Education, it's not just to remember. They're always adding something. Sometimes it's very banal. It's, if you want, it's mere rhetoric, but it's not just to remember. No,
I'm going to pass the mic in a minute, but I just wanted to add, I think we're going back to, with this question, we are going back to the issue of what we remember, whether we remember for a reason or for another. Now, if these museums have the goal to help us remember, there is still a question of what we remember. And an example about Italy that you mentioned before is we have this in 10 days from now, we're going to have the Giorno del Ricordo, to remember the victims of the massacres of the Foibe, of Italians killed by Titus partisans right immediately after the war. Now, if someone sits with an historical eye through the ceremony of January 27th and the one of February 10th, they're really at odds. I mean, it's not possible that we are remembering both things in the same way, in the same society, and from the same perspective. It's just not possible. And what effort can we do to bring these things together? And it's not just a matter of being better people. It's not just a matter of, the memory being educational, but there is perhaps something more to look at things in a non, in a way that doesn't put today's nations on trial, and that's, I think, a step that has not really been taken. We are stuck to the fact that all controversies remain kind of going in a loop. The Holocaust, of course, the Holocaust happened all over Europe, so it's an easy common thread to choose, but then we have to say, as long as we could say, well, it were the Germans who forced everybody else to kill the Jews, it worked in a certain way. When each nation began to look at the fact that, in fact, that people all over collaborated at the persecution and killing of the Jews, then controversies begin to arise. And as if the judgment on what happened then is brought forward to the present. And that's not something that can never be resolved this way.
I agree with you. I don't specifically have. I don't know if that.
Can we overcome that? Can we come to a place where we bring together general memoria, general ricordo.
I don't think so, and I don't think that's an aim. I'll give you the mic very soon. In general, I don't think that a shared memory is real. We have a shared history. History is something specific, what happened, the dynamics, but memory, each of us and each social group and each will have its own, and it's physiological and it's healthy. It's a pluralistic society will have many memories that are at odds with each other. And I don't think that's a problem.
Thank you very much. It's been very interesting to listen to you all. First of all, I'm going to be 80 next year, and I must say that I am, my history has been beginning almost in 1937 when I was born, and the Second World War occurred, and the National Socialists came to power in 1931, 35, 39, and I must say that Europe in its history had been very anti-Semitic. And when I must say something else, that if you are the European Union is rather young, and possibly your history, your idea is more, not objective, but subjective at the moment. And when it becomes more objective, then you will be able to maybe have one museum, and if not no museum, it's perfectly all right. Because what happens as young people grow older, they forget about us. Like our Civil War, very few people really go back, and young people don't have much of a memory of the Civil War here in the United States, and it was a vile, very, very terrible time here. And the same thing will happen about the Second World War. So you have to think very clearly, I think, about what type of memorial or remembrance you're going to put up there. Thank you.
I have a question that relates to our nation in the United States and our new president, who gave a speech when he was inaugurated in favor of nationalism in addition to populism. But in terms of nationalism, I've been thinking, and I wonder if you have international perspectives from many nations, whether there's any possible good that has ever come from nationalism.
Please feel free to.
Well, a nationalist would say yes from his nationalist point of view, of course. No, but you can't ask me to defend nationalism, so I won't do it.
Since it's not complicated enough, I want to add another complication. I want to ask Aline, right? How do you think would a discussion on the genocide of the Herero in Namibia compare with the Holocaust in Germany? If Germany defines the Holocaust as unique, it cannot be compared to any other. This is perpetrated by the same people. And the same, kind of connected to this, to Guri, I think we mentioned in this morning, how more interesting would be a museum of fascism or a discussion of fascism vis-a-vis the Holocaust that also considered the racial policies of, and ideas of fascism across the board, and so the colonial experience of Italy, and once and for all, kind of to break this idea, you know, the idea of Italiani brava gente. But that's it.
Yeah, I think it's very difficult to defend nationalism, particularly in the context we were talking about, and talking about the way I think this is being perceived in Europe. I think there's a lot of worry, if you so want, and that it matches what's happening in the US. I think people are very worried about the developments, not only with farm selection, but obviously the kind of repercussions this might have in European countries where the right-wing parties, extreme right-wing parties are gaining ground. And yeah, I would say there's nothing good that is coming out of this, so that's for sure. So we're sharing your worries here. Concerning the Holocaust and the uniqueness, there's not the attempt to create some kind of hierarchy of saying the Holocaust is at top and all the other genocides are below that. That's not the issue. It's more the question it's the fear, I think, by German politicians to be accused of diminishing the importance of the Holocaust. This is why there's this agreement of non-comparison, if you so want, of saying this is not comparable, it's unique, and we take full responsibility for this. The moment we compare it to something else, we might be accused of trivializing it, of saying this was just one genocide among many other genocides, and it was not special.
That there is in that particular museum an attempt to go beyond this kind of fear of relativizing, right, the Holocaust. And how is that done? You said it's actually speaking to the present much more. It's trying to link that event in history to also, right, issues of by forming citizens who are tolerant, who are accepting, and so on. That is done, right? So there is but it's not done with the memory of also something that historians would say now is related somehow also to what comes afterwards, meaning, right, the policy of genocide in the case of the Herero in today's Namibia, and then, right, the same people somehow, right, the military, and then have also responsibility later. So let's say there is something that historians discuss, the connection between genocide in colonial context and then genocide, the genocide of the Jews. It's not, they're not completely, two completely unrelated issues. It's just a question of complicating the historical narrative in this respect. I mean, actually that particular museum does provide any reference or no?
Well, what it's doing is trying to focus on the kind of dynamics that led to World War II and the Holocaust. So what kind of thought patterns were behind this, for example? What kind of dynamics were pre-existing in society? That's also why it starts, for example, in the interwar years or with World War I and not with 1933 when the Nazis seized power, because it's putting a lot of focus on the kind of dynamics of exclusion, etc., that are still here. They're still here in society, and they have to be contained, if you so want. So what they're trying to do is, by showing these dynamics, show where there are parallels in contemporary society and where we have to be particularly vigilant. That's also why they're calling it the learning center, yeah? Because they say we'd ideally like to educate, and this is one of the issues that we were discussing earlier. We'd ideally like to educate citizens to become vigilant citizens that are prepared to protect values like human rights and democracy.
I wanted to just answer the question very quickly about colonialism. And of course, I totally agree. Italy would need a museum of fascism, and in general, a museum dedicated to Italian colonialism. Personally, I think that the idea of the National Holocaust Museum in Rome, in the very, very vague form in which it has emerged until now, is highly problematic also because there is no reference to colonial racism in any form. Now, it's such a very preliminary phase that we'll see what happens. But I totally agree with you that that should be there. That's certainly important.
Just a very short reflection on nationalism.
Of course, it's a huge topic, but I think just to make it simple, maybe in 19th century, nationalism was a kind of extension of rights and inclusion. It was all the question about inclusion, but it reached a point somewhere when it was all about exclusion. And very often, contemporary societies, at least in Central and Eastern Europe, nationalism is a kind of synonym of exclusion. And that's even the case of Hungary is very special because there are big Hungarian minorities abroad. But and we can say that as soon as nationalist approach is on the plate, these minorities are divided between themselves. So nationalism became a very, actually, very common weapon against even the unity attained previously. So it, actually, it's a very dangerous ideology. And it's even more dangerous when they project it back to history, showing a false interpretation how it came to existence.
Excuse me, I'm in the back. I was intrigued by Professor Schwarz's list of illusions, even though you only mentioned one. And I'm sure there's others, which I'm curious about, because I wonder if that would also apply to another task that seems at hand at this moment of history, not just pure remembrance, not just education of citizens, but possibly also a psychological and spiritual moment, a kind of redemption, maybe a kind of healing that could still happen now, and whether museums have any role in this type of response or this type of, I mean, it's a very big and broad subject, you know, even mentioning spiritual is very, very complicated. But I do know that some museums have a different kind of effect beyond education, beyond remembrance, some kind of an experiential, which, for example, does not happen for the most part in Auschwitz. You know, when people go to Auschwitz, this aspect is almost left in the void. You know, there's no particular attempt to address it. Anyway, it's a huge subject, but I'm curious whether that would be another element that you consider an illusion.
About that, but and I don't know museums that have that kind of adopt that kind of perspective. Well, the other illusions I was thinking about was, for example, the illusion of humanitarian intervention with all the complexities. That case. When we were talking before about, you know, how European, a new season in European consciousness and EU self-representation and relationship to the past change after the Cold War, well, in those same years, well, it was the years of the civil war in former Yugoslavia, which made the idea that, well, it should never happen again, something very, very present, not an abstract concept. And not many years afterwards, you have the intervention in Kosovo. And the language and the rhetoric employed to justify it, well, I don't care if it was good or bad, but was exactly founded on that kind of narrative, the Holocaust-related never again narrative. And you have a whole series of short circuits there. In Italy, it's very obvious that the whole debate on the, Italy's contribution with air bases to the NATO intervention in Kosovo in 99 influences a lot of the parliamentary debates that leads to the introduction of the Holocaust Memorial Day in the beginning of 2000. So that was the illusion I was thinking about in general. Daniel Levy today said we live in a world of in the post-human rights era, meaning that the grand illusion of human rights is problematic, at least. And that was the other illusion I was thinking about.
just one more shift in provocation here. You know, it appears, you know, when you talk about these different museums, both Italy and Germany, but also in Eastern Europe, that particularly the museums that have been planned and interrupted, there is a major question of what would have been in them. And above that, who decides what goes in these museums? So a lot of these museums are an emanation of the states. And, you know, as you illustrate this morning, as governments change, then the people in charge change as well. And so the name of the museums, the scope of the museum changes. Now, what I'm curious is if you could say a little bit about your role. I mean, your role as historians of experts, so-called memory studies, have dedicated your work in an unprecedented way to these issues. And yet, the moment that your countries decide to create one of these institutions, you are not the ones making the decisions.
Just a French example, because we were thinking about that. And you can add the Maison de l'Histoire de France, so the House of French History, which was a project which was never realized, but 7 million euro was spent on it. And that was that showed how a well-organized professional resistance can stop a project. Because that was all about the archivists who would have lost their premises, and they went on a strike for 1.5 years, and they managed to stop it. Not only them, but of course, so the president also had to lose the elections. But altogether, that was efficient. Of course, in other society, in present day Hungary, for example, it was a Jewish community, national and international, who managed to stop the government to realize the House of Fates, which would have been a shame if it's realized. And a good question is, what would have been inside that museum? And it goes to your point that what the government wanted to attain. And I think one important message is the role of responsibility. And so, because all about remembering the Holocaust is the questioning also who was responsible for that. Was it only the Nazis, the perpetrators? So why the community, the Jewish community, didn't resist, especially in the case of Hungary, where the Holocaust took place, where actually it was known, they said it was known what's going on. It started in Budapest in October 44, very late. And the community didn't really resist. It's a question also, who are responsible for that? And of course, the projects I was talking about shows that it's a double victimology. It's a victim's... actually, you're not responsible for your acts. It's fate, House of Fates. So anyone who was a victim didn't deserve it, but couldn't really change it anyway. But the other thing is, of course, it's very political at the same time, that it was the Germans, it was somebody outside. And it goes into the very dangerous interpretation of the past, that in 1956 there was a revolution against the communists, but the West let us, you know, or even if in the case of Poland, 18th century, Western countries or the big countries let this country alone, etc., etc. So in a way, it gives the possibility or give a long duration of victimology that, and I think it can come back. And the other thing which was mentioned before, that of course, with age, also, it's changes. It didn't happen by chance that it's the 70th anniversary, for not just for the Hungarian Holocaust, for many others. I think two or three generations need to. There are pathological cycles of remembrance. So maybe Central Europe or even Europe as such is just leaving that pathological phase of after amnesia, after that we overreact that, so might be reaching a rational grace of this period, or we are going to total chaos and insanity. And there are examples for both. But it's also important to say that, yeah, this is a generation entering which has no experience of that. In the Hungarian case, of course, communism or in Central Europe expanded the amnesia of the Holocaust also. The Holocaust was a problem, of course, it's a big case, and there were many sociologists working on this, how the remembrance of the Holocaust took place on a family level. But actually, it couldn't institutionalize up to the late 80s. And that's too much. There's two generations. And of course, all these problems, all the trauma of the 20th century just got stuck together and exploded in the early 90s. So, of course, maybe it's just one generation after that. So the change, the political change, the fall of the Iron Curtain happened one generation before, 25 years ago. So maybe there's also a changing role in this.
I wanted to bring in an American perspective. African-American theorists like Bryan Stevenson and Ta-Nehisi Coates have been arguing that the United States should follow the example of Germany, that there should be museums built to the atrocities perpetrated against Black Americans, because there has been a total narrative obscuring what happened to Black Americans in American society. So, for instance, there's going to be a museum of lynching opened in Alabama this year. And there's a drive to have more of these museums because the injustices have only been recognized within the African American community and not in the white community at large. So, well, yes, of course. I don't know if you want to respond to that or not, but certainly these people think of Germany as a model.
I think that's generally speaking there's general agreement maybe that Germany among all the countries was maybe the one that found a way of facing this dark past in a fairly successful way. There's a lot of debate about the actual success about this, of course. We should not forget this, and we should not forget that it took some time as well. The 1950s and 60s were not so rosy in that respect. There was a lot of attempt to deny, to draw a line, to not look back but towards the future, etc. And that really only changed in the 1970s for various reasons, for a particular political constellation, etc. I think a big role played, obviously, the very strong international observation of the developments. And we should not forget that, of course, everything that was happening in Germany was observed by the Allies. Which made it very difficult for the country to move out of a certain trajectory. That was not the same in Italy, for example, and I think it explains a little bit why Italy took such a different path. But generally speaking, I think nowadays there's a little bit of an agreement that Germany can be seen as a form of a model, if you so want. If it's applicable universally is another question, right? I think what's often forgotten is that there's a lot of different factors that have to play together to make this a success story. And I'm not quite sure if we can just apply one template to another country.
If I may add just one thing, a few days ago, this politician from AfD made a very German populist movement made a very strong speech saying, we're tired of this. It's a national humiliation. So it's being challenged. And I guess in this way, it hasn't happened in such a public and explicit way before, not that I remember. And it's significant, and I think it's part of the overall general populist climate. But and the fact that this comes out in Germany is particularly meaningful. And but I wanted to add one short thing to answer Alessandro's question, which I interpret as a question regarding the role of the historian as vis-a-vis the state in making memory politics. And well, I think, first of all, there is one thing that Giovanni De Luna pointed out in a very good book called La Repubblica del Dolore on shifting Italian memory policy in the last 20 years. And he went to look at the parliamentary debates for the introduction of all these new memorial laws. And he found out that almost never in the parliamentary debates did books about history or historians, they were almost never mentioned. They were simply out of the picture. Parliamentary debate took a completely different, it moved on another level, okay? And there may be several explanations for this. One, that the cultural level of our members of parliament has declined objectively in last years compared to what it was some decades ago. Another, I think, more relevant is the interconnection between political parties and cultural agencies, which worked during the first 40 years of the Republic, has collapsed since the 90s in different ways, but in the various political areas. And another, more simply, if you look at, and that I think is striking, I mentioned the National Holocaust Museum and the Ferrara Museum about the history of Italian Judaism. There is no public debate about that. There has been no public debate about that. The only debate that has happened was 2 years ago when the Jewish community in Rome and some survivors protested because the Roman Museum was not created. But no intellectual, no meaningful debate between intellectuals, no public interventions by historians. And I think there is a basic reason. Italian historians don't work on that. Italian historiography on the Holocaust is virtually inexistent. It's or very, very limited. And those that work on that were related to the projects in some way or another. So, or related to institutions that had to do with those projects in some way or another. The thing is very different for another hypothetical museum, that is the hypothetical museum of fascism that is supposed to be created in Predappio. Predappio was the birthplace of Mussolini and is the place of pilgrimage 3 times a year of neo-fascist nostalgics who go there on the dates of his birth, his death, and the anniversary of the March on Rome. And there is this idea brought about by the mayor of this little town to build there the National Museum of Fascism in his idea to somehow respond to the nostalgic celebration. I will not get into that, but that stimulated debate. That in that instance, you had 20, 30 historians, intellectuals of various generations, from those of my generations to those who are in their 70s, who participated and discussed, and sometimes the debate has been very, very intense on national media. That produced a discussion, but that discussion, well, was started by an idea of the local mayor, but basically it stemmed from a project from historians, Marcello Flores and Alberto De Bernardi and others. It was scholars who thought about the project, they presented a project, and the project was discussed. In the other instances, you simply have the state saying, we'll do a museum, and they, without telling you what's going to be inside it, and there's not much to discuss about it. It's as if you're presented with a package that is there, closed, done. It's much different.
When we finish this
threat.
So if there is not this museum, there is, however, if you think about all these various, to bring some other actors in this kind of discussion, right? All these various, how do they call them? Institutions for the study of the resistance and the contemporary history, right? Isn't there any kind of activity coming out? Because I see that they are very active now in sort of commemorating always the resistance, and they are also active in organizing the commemoration of the Giorno della Memoria, right? So are they? What is their function? I mean, do they participate in any discussion that goes beyond this kind of specific activities or not? Or they're just, because they exist practically in every province, I believe, in northern Italy, northern and central Italy, of course. I don't know, in the south.
Well, there is a national network of resistance institutes. Uh-huh. And they're very different. Some are big and have resources, and some are very small. So they can do very different things, but in general, the main thing they do is they provide educational activities for high school teachers. Provide high school teachers with ideally instruments to answer to the needs of the students. So everything has in these institutions has become very much connected to the need to answer. The changes brought about by the new memorial laws. The state says you have to celebrate Holocaust Memorial Day. The state says you have to celebrate the memory of the Foibe and so on and so forth. This means that the schools have to do something about it. And not necessarily high school teachers are prepared, because when they studied, these topics were not necessarily there in their curriculum and so on and so forth. And the Istituti Storici della Resistenza do a lot of work on that. I've been working a lot on it with the Istituto di Firenze, but that has become a major activity. It's not the only activity, but I think that has become a major activity. And somehow it shows you how the introduction of the Memorial Days works. It produces an input, especially on the schools, and from the schools you have feedback and the need for a cultural offer.
Yes, I would like to point something. Since we grow as a child, then we develop a curiosity, what's this, what's that, we want to learn. And then as we grow, things change because the society changed that child. A child approach another child and he doesn't see colors, he doesn't see, I cannot talk to that child or that person or that person. Then we impose, oh, no, you cannot talk to that person, you cannot do this with that person. Then we impose different value. Then we have the society, one society conquer another society. And we impose one society to another, and we feel because my army is more powerful than yours, I own your land, I own you. And that's what is happening in the world today. Time ago, a few years ago, was one little child in Tennessee, in the middle school in Tennessee, and he had a friend, a Jewish friend. And their parents said, you cannot play with that friend. You can't go to school. And the child went to the principal and asked about why I cannot play with that child who is a Jew. And the principal said, you should read this book about Anne Frank. That little child read the book and came back to the principal and said, can we do something about it? They built a project called the Paperclips. And they built an international museum
in Tennessee. They collect all the paper clips. The paper clips, they went and read on the history. In Northern Europe, the Jews being persecuted in Northern Europe, being marked not by a star, but by a paper clips. They collected all the stories and the real experience of the Jews and the people who went to the Holocaust. And they had the real wagon who took them to the Holocaust and be killed. I kind of resent how a lot of politicians react on that, because I see many politicians from Europe, from the world. First, they pro-killing another society. Then, 3 months later, they become the best friends. They're the one who support the anti-killing. We live in a false world, in a false world. And that's a reality. Unless we accept one another, we can never stop. We need to revise the way we're learning, the way we live in the world. Yes. I happened to build with my master when I was in South Italy an international museum where we take the child to stay there for 1 week, and he can create artwork, play, eat, and spend 1 week with the international people. And I'm talking about the land which is very, very racist, and they don't allow to talk one another freely if they don't want to. Okay. We built that museum, and that museum is still in existence.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions, observation?
I have a last question.
Thank you. One word I have not heard from you is limits. Seems to me your project must have limits, the limits that come out of the fact that we live in a very complicated world, much more complicated than our brains, minds with which we must face this world. And so it seems to me that I would like to have your reactions to where do you think, how far you can go with the museums or history, if you're writing history. Seems there must be fundamental limits, to my mind. By the way, I should add that this might be a bit surprising. I think we live in a society where we tend to emphasize very much our knowledge, and we tend to ignore our ignorance, and we are very biased in that direction. And so I basically ask you to react to that bias.
I hope we are all aware of our limits, and I don't know if anyone has any other observation or questions. Okay, so thank you, everybody.
In the fall or some other time, with representatives of scholarly work being done in other European countries, particularly, I think, Poland is particularly relevant, Croatia and other ones as well. But thank you so much for all of this, and I'd like to thank the public that stayed with us, and remind you all that we have a couple of other events coming up. On the 26th, we're doing something at the Italian Cultural Institute regarding the internment of foreign Jews in Italy. And as every year on the 27th, we'll have a reading of the names of the Jews deported from Italy and Italian territories at the Italian consulate all day from 9 until 3 or whenever we finished. So once again, thank you very much. And it's been very productive. And I hope that we've provided new perspectives and ideas of how to think about all of these issues and museums in particular. Thank you.